remaining trust, community trust control of the venue will remain exactly the same. They do not permit, for instance, birthday parties from 18 to 25, because they are aware of the potential that could be caused by the trouble that could come to next. A significant thing about this application and the way in which it's been greeted by the people in the area is the fact that statutorily, and I know that I'm afraid to be able to confirm this, we are obliged as applicants to make notices available on the premises and in the press. The statute is what we say. The council are allowed to introduce in their own template how those advertisements are worded. If one, I would to have changed the wording to say, please neighbours, do look, this is not going to identify, it's just to facilitate community or run by trust to work better, then it could be said that I was not complying with the statutory requirement notice. And I was once challenged many years ago because I had put in some explanation at the foot of the notice what the application was intended to show. Those who would oppose me, you can do it, but oppose me on the basis the notice was wrong because I interfered with the statutory definition of what is successful. That doesn't matter. That's why the degree of confusion may have been caused because we were obliged this application with the best I know to have the power. The other application, which is coming before you, if I am successful with this application, is that we de-script or take away the requirement to have a designated premises supervisor, which means effectively were these premises commercial, they would need a designated premises supervisor. And we are asking that to take away some amendments to the licensing act for specifically to deal with community centres, church halls and the like, to enable them to function with a premises license without the rather artificial restriction of 12 temporary residences. So that's my explanation for the point. Great part of the notice period. If I can make one other point, that the act again is very important to the system that allows you to apply for 12 or any building or any part thereof. And were we in any way devious or commercially minded, applications could be made for 12. Occasions a year in the car, 12 occasions a year in the main hall, 12 occasions a year in the the community trust is not taking much that applies. The trustees are honourable people. They seem to come before you to assist, to ask for assistance in running the premises as a better community asset. They do not aim to change the relations they have with their neighbours. The fact that there is no representation from any of the responsible authorities, I believe, speaks volumes. So the premises will continue to operate in exactly the same way. It is hoped that the two or three occasions a year that are missed because people come for the license because of 12 that they use, so that this application will solve that problem. That is my application, so that we are going to answer any questions.
Given that the trust will be the premises license holder, how will the trust ensure that the license is rejected or upheld if, as you say, the organisations will be selling the alcohol?
In exactly,
coming back to the same question.
In exactly the same way, sir, as they have done for the last 9 years of operation of temporary event notices, by making certain that bodies that rent the premises from them have appropriate person in place to ensure that those controls are met. Before temporary event notices, there were occasional permissions or occasional affected in exactly the same way, that there are functions which limit the committee, the trustees do not allow to take place because they would fear it would not be good for the neighbourhood. They are looking after, or trying to look after those people who hopefully benefit from the hall. So it's not a question of appointing anybody, Mark, to have that responsibility. It's a question of maintaining what we've been doing for a number of years and making sure that those who rent the facility are responsible and control what is going on in it exactly the same way a toilet can operate and the margin can be different as well.
Chair,
I'm going
to be able to assist. It does appear a little bit confusing. I'll start with the temporary vent notice process and how that works in terms of people using Westbourne board. And I understand that what's happened to date is that if somebody wants to be a functioner at the board, then they apply for the temporary vent notice, not a member of the management committee, if only people who are wanting to use it. And as such, they are what's needed for the premises user, and they do have full liability during the time they are acting under that temporary vent notice. The situation does change with a premises licence in place, and as you're familiar with a premises licence, there's usually a designated premises supervisor who has to have a personal licence to be a designated premises supervisor, and under normal circumstances, that is the individual who holds accountability for the alcohol that is sold at the premises under that license. The situation, as Mr. Holland has referred to, is that with this application, at the same time as making an application for a premises license, the applicant is asked for that condition related to designated premises supervisors to be what's called disapplied. And in place of that, what happens is that it is the management committee who hold responsibility for the alcohol that is sold at that premises under that premises license. It would no longer be the users of the premises who would be responsible. It would in fact be the management committee. They would be held liable for any issues relating in particular to underage sales or such. So moving to a premises license away from temporary vent notices moves the responsibility away from those people who are using the premises to the management community. That helps.
And my explanation to, if you remember when I addressed you, was the selection events will remain in exactly the same position as the years before the trustees. So technically speaking, they were before choosing who could go there, the responsibility would be for the temporary benefit is older. Now the responsibility doesn't move away, but the selection process and the controls will remain with the trustees.
Again, going back to our question about how the trust will ensure we need to do something that hopefully will be more events being held at the premises under this license if granted.
We think
how
will
the trust ensure that the licensing objectives are upheld, even though you're saying there won't be that much of a change. But presumably, if it's a, say, a birthday party, you don't necessarily know as an organisation what those people are like. And how they are going to manage a bar, and therefore how the trust, as if granted the license holders, will ensure that the licensing objectives are upheld.
The licensing objectives will be upheld, so by the investigation that the trustees will do, there are forms to be completed which have been submitted with the application. So the notice that police are investigating who will be the responsible people and how the operator proposed to carry out. That process will not change, sir, and it is the skill and the proof of putting up in the evening that the premises run successfully under both the new system and the 64A now for many, many years. With similar decisions being made, where the responsibility has changed, that's the only thing that's changed. The responsibility of these two trustees are with me and the other members of the trust body will remain the same. Their assiduous attention to detail, every single reporting is referred to the trust to make their decisions on their experience, and as I understand it, so are quite happy on occasion to refuse. So you
exercise personal supervision. So basically, a member of the trust or a member of staff would supervise the sale of alcohol. Yeah. Although not
fully. Supervise the premises.
Yeah, supervise the premises and then ensure, therefore, that the license and objectives are withheld and the license is
granted. There's not a future again. It's not a member of the trust or working behind the bar, and have on those occasions if we don't to the individual tech against. So we want some type of it or the management of the council on the evening for the committee member 10 to make sure that the necessary licensing objectives are being met, or is it just a question of that the assessing each application and then left at that what
assess the application. Notices as a excluding children in the area during its concern, even in the private parties, and the member of staff or the member of the trustees will obviously monitor that as well.
So who actually seals the alcohol? That would be the.
That would be Adam. Well, you have a form of who's responsible. They have to make four stewards.
Make four months in the education.
And they manage the bar, that they actually serve behind the bar.
So have we ever had cause to step in relation to perhaps a different interpretation of that
subject? By and large, there are very few events some of the shows
having been involved as someone who said for 10 years just as you said that I see a very great change in the type of drink which is served these days. Many years ago when drinking and driving was considered more important, people would drink I find these days that we sell far more caterers and non-alcoholic drinks because most of the people attending these functions drive for them, and nobody these days will chew half a dozen pints of beer into the can and get in the car back home. And this is why you find certain non-alcoholic drinks far now outweighs the alcoholic drinks. People who come and have a glass of wine to an evening and then this kind of thing. And also, in addition to the fact that, of course, we also be concerned that there are responsible people behind the bar, there are also quite a lot of those who say, no drinks served or no drinks people who may be. But as I say, there has been this very positive change in the type of alcohol.
Can I just ask a question? What about disposal of the class bottles?
They're all disposed in one of the big, you know, containers and take away every week or so. People are not allowed to keep bottles outside premises. You know, if granted, the license would be for the premises and not the surrounding area. And again, to my knowledge, I've never known anybody to broke the bottles in the car or anything like this. Within the serving area, there are containers where the empty bottles can be put. They get turned by normally the airplane before. So the next day or whenever, I'll put in one of the big containers which are then collected regularly by the police disposal people.
Do you lay down any conditions as to when they can be thrown into the bin? Hours. So that would be quite disturbing, you know.
What, if any, measures do you take with regards to noise pollution in the process?
I think my research has shown that there is no objection from environmental health in terms of noise pollution. If there had been, then we would enter into discussion, as I said to you before the hearing started. If there are going to be, or if there are problems, then a line of communication should be open so that steps can be taken. Because of the nature of the poor, it's not as though you're driving commercially to make money. Most of the people who come to the poor are charitable organisations or self-help organisations. And if there's a problem, then the committee, the trustees, would see to it that it ceased immediately because they are dependent on the community for their support and business, and they operate for communities, gentlemen aren't paid. So, in terms of when you say what steps are taken, the building had £250,000 spent on by the Borough Council before it was handed over to the trust. And if there are steps that may have been taken, and I have no idea what they would be, because there has been no feedback from the local authority. In terms of noise pollution, I can only say the trust is functioning to the best of its abilities. It has done for its various guises, probably for 40 or 50 years. So when you say what steps are being taken, premises are being responsibly run. There is no representation from environmental health. It would have been here like a shock if there were a problem.
So, to understand your answer, there are no specific policies in place to try and ensure that people who rent out before.
Well, I got rid of the Sunderland last year because I felt a little bit nice. Just by being in an housing department, noticing what's going on, I'm monitoring in that sense by being there. Just came into the time when we were having some work, so I was having to do quite a lot. And I noticed that all the windows down one side were open, and as soon as it was pounding out, the doors were open as well. So I went in and had a look with the staff, and they had a look with the group until they just closed the windows. And of course, some of them should be warm.
To pull them down.
Double doors, you can open them that way. and the neighbours opposite don't get things, but traffic could have passed them all, hasn't it? But the neighbours down the side, it could have disturbed them. So I went back in the time and we were there again, it was very disturbing. So when they came to renew for the next 12 months,
yes, you will have our written representation in response to the application for you. We live adjacent to the hall on one of the side streets. And we're concerned about the grant of the license. Since there's already a lot of light and noise pollution coming from the hall, if you feel that the grant during unrestricted alcohol license to increase this. I understand that there's a number of red adverts in the
but you check, there isn't any to be taken of what you're saying. You just slow down slightly.
Sorry, yes.
Because I think, for all of your accents, I think we just need to pick a better thing that we can.
Of course.
Okay.
So, in addition to the letter that we sent, perhaps I will only respond to some of the points that were raised here. In particular, I'm aware the Zumba group. There were, in fact, complaints from neighbours about the noise of the Zumba group, and I'm pleased to hear that eventually this was resolved. But I know this took a certain amount of time. So yesterday, again, we had noise in the afternoon. And the way that the hall is, the way that it's situated, if there is loud music playing inside, I don't know whether it is because the windows are open, or whether it is because the hall is not well noise insulated, or because the music is very loud inside. But when we have our windows closed, we can hear the noise inside the house, in our rooms. In fact, not only in the front, the back of the house, close to the hallway, in the front of the house. So this is very noticeable on occasions at the moment. And there are young children in the street. We don't have children yet, but we're expecting one. Our neighbors have children. And certainly we are worried, we're concerned about the grant of an alcohol license. Which will surely not make these problems any easier, it already exists. Now, it was stated that the way the hall is run has not changed just to Dover, but this is not how we as residents have felt it. And certainly, as we emphasized, and I should say, I have no interest in shutting down Westbourne Hall or making the Hall a popular society whose space. In fact, we value the value to the community of the hall there. But we have noticed certainly that there has been an increase in noise pollution, and we have not felt that the management of the hall has been very responsive to the complaints. There was one incident, which I know you're aware of light pollution, where there was a spotlight essentially shining into one of our rooms. And it took two visits to the hall and nothing changed. Eventually we contacted Mr. Wade. At that point, still nothing had changed. We contacted